Back in the late 90s and early 2000s, a company named Matchbox released a whole bunch of World War II-era die-cast aircraft. Now, the cool thing about this is that they were well-made and feature great paint apps, and best of all, they didn't really cost much. In fact, if I remember correctly, you could pick them up at Walmart for like 19 bucks, or maybe like $19.99. And back in the day, man, I really just went crazy for these things, and thankfully I still have them. So today I thought I'd just post up a little video and show off some of the models that I have. I'm going to break this up because I have quite a few of them. I'm going to break this up into like a little mini series. So to begin, what you see in front of you is going to be the Supermarine Spitfire. Now this is going to be the Mark 1A version, which would be more famous for its role in the Battle of Britain. So the Spitfire is a very beloved aircraft. There's people who contest that this is one of the best looking fighter aircraft ever made. And let's face it, it is a very fluid and graceful looking plane. Now what I like so much about the Matchbox collection is this, just the build quality. What you got for the money, even back then, was just stupendous. Now, to start things off, the stand was pretty basic, just made of basic plastic materials, nothing too fancy, nothing too heavy. However, the only problem I ever really had is sometimes this little peg right here. I sometimes struggled to make a good, to have a good fit on the aircraft, and sometimes the peg was almost too much of a good fit, and I actually had to borderline trim this down a little bit. But otherwise, it was the only real issue I ever had with them. The aircraft itself was incredibly, incredibly solid. For example, the wings right here, die-cast. The body, die-cast. The only parts that are really plastic, at least on this model, is the propeller back here. And of course, the rear's back here. Otherwise, this is almost all predominantly a die-cast model, and it featured some decent detail, like what you see right here with some of the black burn marks from the guns firing off. And in this case, since it's the old model, this would be the 8.303 Browning machine guns. So the Spitfire, particularly this variant of the Spitfire, was famous for its role in the Battle of Britain. When, you know, the funny thing is, the Spitfire took all the glory, but it was actually the Hawker Hurricane that did most of the grunt work. But, you know, it is what it is. As far as this model goes, I think it's absolutely fantastic. And that's going to be pretty much my general synopsis of almost everything that I review here. The paint apps are fantastic, the build quality is fantastic, and for 19 bucks, come on. So next up, we're going to have the Mark II version of the same aircraft. And to be honest with you, as far as this is concerned, the only difference is going to be the paint app. And I guess I could also see why. This is going to be the Mark II, and the differences between the Mark II and the Mark I, as far as casting is concerned, was pretty mitigated. It also features, of course, the same armament here. But again, I absolutely love this paint job. I think I like it actually better than the brown paint job. But yeah, I have to agree, this is a very timeless aircraft. And I think it's so awesome that many of these still fly to this day. So, next. In fact, you know what? Before I even go to next, I forgot to mention this. I'm not sure if my camera is going to be able to show this off or not, but they really didn't skimp on detail here. Like, the pilot is actually incredibly detailed. You have the glasses and the visors are distinctly different from the band. The hat's one color, it's brown, then you have the fleshy tone, then you have a blue scarf, and then you have a yellow, like, life preserver, and then you have, you can't really see it on camera, I don't believe, but then you have, of course, the green outfit. Like, that is stupidly good detail for such an inexpensive aircraft. So whoever was heading this project, I mean, they didn't want to screw around. I mean, they really were dedicated to producing the best product that they could for the money. And I really wish it was still like that today. Let's see. And next we have, it would only be appropriate to show off the Bf 109, Germany's equivalent to the Spitfire. And, you know, debate's going to rage on endlessly as to which fighter aircraft was better performing and so on and so forth. And I'm not even going to get into that. I'm just going to admire the model itself. Now, this one's not completely perfect, as you notice right here. This is slightly bent down, but I mean, that's pretty forgivable. Otherwise, the paint job on this is amazing. I think this was the Squadron JDG-52. This might even be Eric Hartmann's plane, who's one of the highest scoring aces of all time. If not the highest scoring aces of all time. So you're going to have to forgive me, guys. I'm not too brushed up on my history here, but I do know that the Bf 109 was involved in the Spanish Civil War before the breakout of World War II, and I believe it was also the most widely produced aircraft, fighter aircraft, in history. I think it was like 3,900 of these guys were made, which is pretty crazy. So, but yeah, this aircraft is fantastic. Build quality, it's just like the Spitfire. It's just almost solid aluminum except for the two extremes here. Just absolutely fantastic. And lastly for this video, we have my personal favorite, at least of the three, the Focke-Wulf. Now this is the FW-198. Now this thing came out in 1941, and when it hit the scene, man, I mean, it was just such an advanced aircraft. I love the paint job on it. I don't know if this was a particular ace that Matchbox was trying to honor. Unfortunately, that was just on the packaging, so if you threw away the packaging like I did, yeah, you'd have to have it committed to memory. But anyways, fantastic looking aircraft. You can see here the very ominous 20mm cannons. This thing actually had four of them. So when this plane came out, though, it was absolutely astounding. It was actually even better than the Bf 109 at medium, especially low altitudes. It could maneuver a bit better and was a little bit quicker as well. So it was just, it was a monster of an aircraft. Unfortunately, though, it wasn't very good at intercepting bombers simply because its performance just kind of dropped significantly above 20,000 feet, so that was remedied later on when the Focke-Wulf D series aircraft were introduced. Of course, by that time, one could argue the war had already been decided, but nonetheless. And just like with the Spitfire, we have a very detailed pilot. And yeah. So guys, this is going to conclude the video. I hope you enjoyed watching it, and for some of you, maybe taking a walk down memory lane. This is a really, really cool series, and I'm very, very thankful to have bought it when I did. All right, guys, thanks, and take it easy. Bye.